This is the Tennessee River just outside the stadium. The Volunteer Navy started arriving as early as Thursday. Inside, the new grass turf and the famous checkerboard end zone tells you you could only be one place, Knoxville, Tennessee. The tradition of the player walk to the stadium just prior to game time reminds you of modern gladiators marching off into battle. Tennessee fans come by the thousands from every large city and small hamlet to see those gladiators play this game we call college football. Coach Steve Spurrier and his Florida Gators. Spurrier has won much and has won often since coming to the Swamp. But this is one battlefield that has thwarted his every advance. And here come the Florida Gators. And now one of the great spectacles in all of college football. When that tee goes north and splits open, the Tennessee Volunteers will arrive to the cheers of 96,000 faithful. And here they come. Ron Franklin, along with Mike Gottfried, and welcome to CFA Primetime. Doesn't get a lot better than this. Who is the beast of the East in the Southeastern Conference? Mike, in about 3 hours, we're going to know. But just as the tease indicated a moment ago, of all the success that Steve Spurrier has enjoyed as a head coach, this is one place that he has not been able to get into the victory column.
You're right, Ron, and this is the best football team Steve Spurrier brings to Tennessee tonight. And if he wins this football game, by his schedule, he very well could be 10-0 going into Florida State at the end of the year.
With two awfully good teams like this, as you might imagine, this game is not without its stars. First of all, for the Gators at quarterback, Terry Dean. Look at these numbers. 16 possessions, 13 touchdowns. He is the efficiency leader nationally as a passer. And how about Tennessee? They call him Little Ben, but last week he was not small at all. James Stewart with 211 yards, four touchdowns against Georgia. Last year, though, Florida put a stop on him. He can't have that happen here tonight. Mike Godfrey, not to oversimplify this thing, but if you said if there is a key or keys in this football game to victory, what's it going to be?
Very simple, Ron. The team that runs the football wins this game tonight.
So even you think that Florida, rather than throwing as much as they have, they'll run it?
Two-dimension football team, but they have to establish the run.
Well, there is still another element that we have not discussed that has been large in the last few years determining the winner. Let's go down to Mike Adamley on the field, and he has more on that. Michael.
Well, Mike and Ron, coaches are always harping about the importance of special teams, especially if the weather gets bad like it could tonight. The Volunteers and Gators know that all too well. In fact, the last four meetings, kicking game has had a huge impact. 1990, Dale Carter broke the Gators back with this 90-yard kickoff return as Tennessee rolled 45-3 in Knoxville. 91, Florida blocked this Tommy Hutton punt to set up a score in their 35-18 win in Gainesville. In 92, Gator punter Shane Edge had the favorite return. The Volunteers stuffed the kick and salted away a 31-14 victory. And last season, Nilo Sylvan's fumble on the opening kickoff of the second half helped deflate a Volunteer comeback as Florida prevailed 41-34. Pay attention, because if the weather gets bad, special teams could be very crucial again tonight.
Tennessee has won the toss. They elected to defer. We'll be back with the opening kickoff after this. As far as attendance, many of the locals say they thought it would be a record crowd. This is John Bexford about to kick it off to number one Jackson or number three Larry Kennedy. This one's underway. It's going to go to Jackson's side at the seven. Return to the open side of the field. Gets a block, breaks it open. 35 at the 40. Bexford in pursuit. Knocks him just enough off balance, and he will take it all the way inside the 35 to the 32-yard line. Bexford saved 6 points.
Ron, Florida has made a special effort on special teams. Ron Zook last year's defensive coordinator is in charge of this, and they have taken a lot of pride this year in the special teams. Jack Jackson trying to work way to the wide side of the field, picked up a lot of good blocks, and the one thing you don't want to do with this Florida offense is give them great field position, and Tennessee has allowed that to begin this ball game.
I mean, if Bexford does not get a piece of him, then there is no way he's kept from scoring. Steve Johnson finally knocked him down. It's a 60-yard return. Swings the pass out to Williams. And Elijah Williams has 5 yards, has 10 yards, hit with an ankle-high tackle, and Florida all of a sudden inside the 20-yard line. The Russell Athletic starting lineups for the Florida Gators. Terry Dean, the trigger man, 11 touchdowns, no interceptions. Also has not been sacked. The wide receivers, Jack Jackson, he's a big-time player, very talented group. In two games, Jackson has 4 touchdowns. And up front with the offensive line, Jason Odom, only a junior, but the pro scouts think that he is a great one. Movement, and this will be procedure against the Florida Gators. It'll be 1st and 15. So that gives us an opportunity to check the defensive starters for the Tennessee Volunteers.
False start, movement, offensive right tackle, 5 yards.
And here they are, Steve White. Very good ball game last week. He also broke a bone in his hand. He is playing with a cast on that right hand. The linebackers, number 93, look for Scott Galen. He's a local from just down the road at Seymour. Had a big game last week. And in the secondary, injuries and illness galore. Ron Davis had an interception last year against Florida. He needs to come up big again tonight. Draw play, big opening, 5, 10, and inside the 15 to the 14-yard line as defensively George Kidd comes up to make the stop on Williams. And Mike, I would say right now, Tennessee needs this tone to slow down quickly.
Well, you want to keep your crowd in the ball game, and what you have to do with the Florida offense, they give you the deception of being a passing team, but when you look at their statistics, they run just as much as they throw the ball. And they're very tough on draws. You just see, we're able to see Elijah Williams on that first draw play pick up good yardage.
4 wide receivers. Elijah Williams is the man behind Terry Dean. And he goes out in the pattern. That's who he lobs it to, and it's complete to Williams inside the 10, close to the 9-yard line, and Scott Galen makes the stop.
You look at the play selection. Every offense wants to stay two-dimensional. They want to be able to run the ball and pass the ball. That's everybody's goal. 82 rushes, 81 passes coming into this game tonight. That is balance, and that's what you like to have as an offense.
You think he's nervous? He knows one thing. You got to take this 96,000 out of the ball game. You got to make something happen
immediately.
Early. Yeah.
He's trying to get a timeout.
Flags go down as the quarterback sneak will take it for the first down. Now, Mike, did the 25-second clock run out? Jimmy Harper, a referee.
Ron, they only had 10 men on the field. That's why Steve Spurrier was trying to get a timeout. One of the receivers did not go on the field, so they only had 10 men. He wants the timeout. He knows he has a bad situation. Still picked up the first down, but somebody must have moved.
One of the local sports writers wrote a story today and said tongue-in-cheek that if Spurrier throws his visor 5 times or more, it's a good night for Tennessee.
And, Ron, you're looking at that graphic. Florida has been penalized 10.5 times in each ball game this year. It's been somewhat of a problem for them.
You can see Dean asked Bilkey to go in motion. Third down, about 5.5. Pass is tipped, and it's intercepted. Ben Talley at the 13-yard line.
Ron, remember the penalty, because that's really what upset this Florida football team. Ball was tipped by Leland Taylor, number 57, and Ben Talley, who Larry Marmy, the defensive coordinator, calls the playmaker on our defense, makes a big play here to bring this crowd back into this football game. Another look, the tip. Ben Talley dropped off the line of scrimmage for the interception.
Flag went down. Tennessee penalized for holding on the return.
but I can promise you that Phil Fulmer right now, as you look at Todd Helton going into his huddle, doesn't care about field position. He's just glad that he's got the rock right now.
He's breathing again.
Stewart takes it for maybe one, and let's take a look at the starting lineups. First of all, for the Tennessee Volunteers, James Littleman Stewart, great game last week, but last year he was held to 5 yards on 8 carries. He's got to have a big game tonight. Wide receivers, Billy Williams, last year 3 touchdowns against the Florida Gators. And in the offensive front, a very talented group, the only senior in the lineup, Kevin Mays out of Kingston, Tennessee. He thinks they can run on the Gators. Elton, the left-hander, swings out his first pass. Joey Kent breaks off a tackle, and he will have a very large Tennessee first down. Here are the starters on defense for the Florida Gators. This is a fine defensive line. Kevin Carter, big play man, but a lot of people say that Ellis Johnson next to him is even tougher. That left side is heck, though. The linebackers, Dexter Daniels, number 48, the most experienced player at linebacker, and Larry Kennedy in the secondary, 39 consecutive starts for the Florida Gators. Play action, rolls it to the other side, throws it complete to Billy Williams, and Williams will take it to the 37, maybe the 38-yard line.
Ron, Florida knows they have to stop the Tennessee running game. Tennessee on the other side wants to come out and throw the football. Little play action passes, and Todd Helton is the best when he's moving. Throws the pass to Billy Williams for a nice completion, but this game's going to be won in the trenches. One of these two teams has to develop the run.
Johnny Church has come in the lineup replacing Kevin Carter at that left defensive end spot. And James Stewart will take it for maybe a gain of 1. Dexter Daniels is the first man, the junior out of Valdosta, Georgia, to get to it.
Tough defensive front. I think Florida's defensive line may be the best, one of the best in the country, led by Kevin Carter, number 57. Ellis Johnson, number 61. Kentucky double-teamed him all night last week. Still did not have any success against him.
The expression was used this week that of that front seven of Florida, that probably 5 of those guys would play on Sundays and maybe more. Short drop this time, and the pass is thrown high, and Joey Kent really had to pay for it as Kennedy came over and put the wood on him.
The short passes for Tennessee they're going to be open because Florida has to find a way to stop the running game. They're going to try to get the 7th guy in the box some way. On the last play, it was Ben Hanks, number 11. Try to overpower that offensive line.
So Florida, on the opening kickoff, gets a return of 60 yards. They move it inside the 10-yard line, then a penalty and an interception by the Volunteers. Flag goes down, pass is thrown incomplete at the 50-yard line. It's going to be an illegal receiver downfield, says Jimmy Harper in the preliminary signal.
That illegal participation, 12 men on the field for the offensive team. Penalty is declined, 4th down.
12 men in the field.
Ron, Mike Adamley set up the situation with special teams. Florida's already had a kickoff return. They really try to go after punt blocks and field goal blocks tonight because Ron Zook really believes that they can get to a punt.
Tom Hutton, his longest kick, 49 yards, and Cervona Palmer is back in a single safety for the Gators. Left-footer's kick, good driving spiral. Palmer catches it and runs out of bounds inside the 20. 41 yards on the kick and nothing on the return. So let's take a break. 10:40 remaining, first quarter, no score. What you're looking at, this was last night at the Thompson Bowling Arena here on the campus of the University of Tennessee. They had over 13,000 people at that pep rally, and we're told that even Jerry Clower showed up. No score. The second offensive possession for the Florida Gators, and Mike, another of the freshmen, has now come in. Fred Taylor at tailback, replacing Elijah Williams.
A little bigger back, but still can go the distance.
And they send him out on the route. They're going to go on top, looking for everything. Got a man open. It is complete at the 35-yard line to Anthony.
In Florida's package, when they throw the football, they like to have a deep route, then a medium route, and a short route. It's a high-low principle where they have somebody always behind you and somebody in front of you. Ronald Davis, number one, just beaten badly on the post.
This Florida Gator football team, we have not played 5 minutes of football yet. They have had a 60-yard return and now a 49-yard pass play. They swing the ball out. This is Fred Taylor. Gets by one tackle. And now is going to be wrapped up after maybe a gain of one. And Mike Tirico, let's get a first report from you.
Ron, we're keeping a close eye on the Notre Dame-Michigan State game. Down by six, Ron Paulus to Robert Farmer. The touchdown and the extra point put Notre Dame up one, but Paulus has been picked off four times, including this one, late in the fourth quarter by Demetrius Martin, but Michigan State had to punt, and Notre Dame has the ball back.
Draw play. Taylor to the right side. Down to the 25-yard line. He's about a yard and a half shy of the first down.
This is Florida's practice on Thursday, and Steve Spurrier said this is the best offensive line that he's had at Florida, and it gives him a lot of options, Ron, because first of all, you throw the ball, but the running attack is a lot better than people think.
You know, Mike, when you look across that front group, it's almost like somebody called Central Casting and said, give me everybody 6'5", 6'6", 295, or 300. That's the size of every one of them.
Fire plugs.
Call fire plugs. Straight ahead, Dean with the quarterback sneak, and you could see that huge push for the offensive line. Let's go to Mike Adamley. Mike?
Well, Ron, you would never guess that about an hour ago there was a torrential downpour. Of course, you know that for the first time since 1967, the University of Tennessee is playing on natural grass. This stuff is something called Tifway 419. It's a hybrid Bermuda grass. It drains extremely well. There's a layer of sand and gravel, and it stays very, very firm. I don't think grass or the surface is going to be any kind of problem this evening.
Mike, this is a very fast track, even if we had not had rain. We haven't seen any slips so far. Dean over the middle, complete at the 10-yard line, very close to the first down as Doring was coming back toward his quarterback, Jason Parker, on the tackle.
Well, when you look at Steve Spurrier, the interesting thing about him when he calls a football game, no headsets. He's calling this game strictly on his own. Now, he'll go to a headset. He'll talk to somebody upstairs, but these plays and formations are in his head right now. He said when he was at Duke, he had to trial and error type of making up his offense. He said he made up formations and plays just to keep his defense off the field. But he's got a good scheme, Ron, but it's all in his head. It's a one-man operation. Now, he gets a lot of help from his assistants, but without those headsets on, he's calling this game.
It's hard to say when it comes to play calling on Saturday afternoon or Saturday night, it's the SS man. Steve, he calls his own show. Pitch, left side, big opening, and Tater. Wow, he gets whacked just before he gets to the 5-yard line. Jason Parker has to come up from his free safety position again.
Sean Nunn, number 80, the tight end that they inserted into the ball game. They usually play with four receivers, bring Sean Nunn into the game. Real key block on that play for Fred Taylor.
You know, Mike, for coaches who have got this team on their schedule, they sit there and think, you lose a guy like Eric Rett, who was a great football player, and they don't miss a stride. In fact, they may have three guys that are going to replace him. Draw play. Here's one of them at the two, at the one. Touchdown, Florida Gators, and Fred Taylor.
The offensive line again, you get so conscious of rushing the passer that they hit the draw on you. Reggie Green, number 78, with a big block, and Fred Taylor, in all fairness to Eric Rett is a fine football player. Their run offense last year ended up 75th in the country. This year they have two game breakers in Elijah Williams and Fred Taylor. Fred Taylor has some wiggles and some speed.
Judd Davis knocks home the extra point. And the Florida Gators, with 8 minutes showing on the stadium clock, have gone in front. They have been extremely impressive in the opening moments of this first quarter. Well, the offensive line of the Florida Gators sitting and getting a well-deserved break. 7 plays, 82 yards, 2 minutes and 40 seconds, a 7-yard run by Tater. But Odom, Mitchell, Swain, Young, and Green simply devastating in that, actually, the first two drives. Nino Silva from inside the five. Breaks the tackle at the 20. Ball comes loose. It goes out of bounds. And now one. Here's the second flag coming in.
Face mask, Ron. They'll tack a few more yards on for Tennessee.
We have an inadvertent face mask. 5-yard penalty. First down, Orange.
Well, from the reverse angle, you'll be able to get a look at Sylvan being grabbed over the face mask right there. It is a 37-yard return, and that's Mike Harris, a freshman out of Gainesville, who grabbed him by the mask, and then he fumbled the football, but it went out of bounds. Aaron Hayden in a tailback, but they go with a handoff to the fullback. There is a gain of one as Mose Phillips gets his first carry of the night. Kevin Carter, senior out of Tallahassee, 6'6", 271 pounds. They roll the pocket his direction. Pressure on Helton, and he is going to be devoured. You'll have to split that sack by three different ways because Carter and Johnson get there along with Kevin Freeman. Freeman probably the biggest surprise on this Gator defense, though, Mike.
Ron, you can talk all about offense all you want, but this is the best defense that Florida's had since Steve Spurrier's arrived as a head football coach. And what makes them good is the pressure they get up front. Kevin Carter, number 57, Ellis Johnson, number 61. The left side of the Florida defense, pretty tough. I think I'd go away from them for a while.
Tennessee will go with a shotgun. Third down. The line to make is their own 47. Movement at the line of scrimmage, and it looked as though the slot man moved just a half step before the ball was snapped. Let's check in quickly with Mike Tirico.
And Ron, it's a final in Lincoln. They wanted a big performance out of their Cornhuskers to prove that they think they're number one. Tommy Frazier and Eric Alford, 2 touchdown passes as the Huskers win.
Third down and they go with the draw play. Hayden tries to break off the tackler but cannot get away from Ben Hanks. And Tennessee's punting unit will have to come on the field. And we're about to see the Florida Gators for the third time tonight.
Ben Hanks with a big play. He was a defensive back in high school. He said when he was a freshman, he came here, was really depressed. 95,000 people standing on the side. He was standing on the sideline getting yelled at. And he said he heard enough of Rocky Top. He does not want to hear that this year. Good play by Hanks on that stopping the runner.
Hutton, they're coming after him. Gets his kick away easily, though. Palmer signals for the fair catch and makes it at the 23-yard line. So let's take a break. 7-0. Florida leads. We'll be right back. As the rain start again here in Knoxville, 7-0, Florida leads. And don't forget, ESPN's college football is on live. You can chat with us on ESPNNet right after this ball game tonight. If you've got ESPNNet and Prodigy, just jump, chat, and head for the sports section. And if you don't have ESPNNet yet, call 1-800-ESPN-PRO to subscribe. Elijah Williams comes back at a tailback for Florida. Pitch goes to Williams. There's the zone play. Cuts it back to the left. He'll have over 10 yards on the carry again.
When you look at both of these football teams, when they run the ball well, Florida the last 5 years, 150 plus yards rushing, they're 26-1. Tennessee in the last 7 years, when they rush for 200 yards, 38-1-1. That's why I say it's a must to get the running game going, both of these football teams.
Well, for all the people that thought that for the world the Gators were nothing but a throwing football team, they have shown you how well they do run the football in these opening two sequences. Leland Tater steps up into the hole this time. He will greet Williams and stop him for his shortest gainer of the night.
Ron, last year in the Georgia game for Florida, it rained the whole ball game. Danny Werfel started the ball game, was not playing effectively. Terry Dean threw the ball well in the pregame, and Steve Spurrier noticed that he threw the ball well in the rain, pulled him, and then he went on to be 8-for-12 for 105 yards, and they won the football game.
51-8 so far in rushing yardage. 7-0, Gators lead. Tennessee coming with a corner blitz. Pressure is there, pass underthrown, and it was because of that pressure from the secondary that he had to rush his throw. Raymond Austin was the guy coming with the pressure.
A lot of teams like to use the philosophy when you see no backs in the backfield. Rather than be sitting there, they like to bring pressure. Here, Tennessee, from the top of the screen, there's no back, so there's no running game except the quarterback draw. Pressure them, try not to allow them to get the football off. They were successful. Raymond Austin, number 28 on the blitz.
It's the first time tonight that they have pumped Dean as he's throwing the football. Right over the middle, it is caught right in stride. That's Jack Jackson, and he is in Tennessee territory. They'll mark him down at the 43.5-yard line. 18 yards of the pass play.
Well, when you're throwing the football in zone, you try to anticipate the window in the zone. There's going to be a window, and you have to anticipate it. Now, you see how close covered that is, but there's a window to get the ball into Jack Jackson. When you're going against man coverage, you want to throw away from the man defender. But zone, there's a little window in there you have to hit. Terry Dean right on the mark.
Taylor back in a tailback. Pitch goes to him. Bobbled it for a moment and now is going to turn it into a positive as he takes a headgear right off of Raymond Austin. And let's check with Mike once again down on the sideline.
Well, Ron, one of the problems that defensive coordinator Larry Marmee of Tennessee was talking about was his lack of able bodies in the secondary. Cornerback Deron Jenkins is out with a pulled groin. Backup safety Shane Begno is out. And after Sean Summers and Steve Johnson, just a freshman, the coverage is bare. So a lot of pressure tonight on Terry Fair and Ron Davis. This is the third big test in a row after Wayne Cook and Eric Zier. Now that they got to deal with Florida's run and gun and Terry Dean. Gentlemen.
Okay, just as you made the call, Raymond Austin, we said a headgear got knocked off. It was his, and he has had to be taken to the sideline, and you could see he's a little wobbly.
Well, and don't think that Steve Spurrier doesn't notice that Terry Ferris closest to his bench, and he's a true freshman out of Phoenix, Arizona.
They look to throw, and they go right in Fair's area. Jackson puts his shoulder down and goes head-on-head with him at the 23-yard line. Fair, who they were picking on, makes the stop.
They just spread you out so much that they're going to get the one-on-one that they want. Here's Terry Fair, the freshman, and a very good athlete, but he's still a freshman working against Jack Jackson. Makes the tackle, big cushion. Steve Spurrier noticed it right off the bat. I'm sure he's going to work on Terry Fair.
15 yards on that pass play. Quick pass. Aubrey Hill. Complete inside the 20. He's down to the 17. Ronald Davis was single up on coverage with him. And they will give him forward progress to the 15-yard line.
This is what makes him so tough, Ron, because they spread you out. You have to play with five defensive backs against them on the outside to remove a linebacker. That leaves you six in the box to play against that running game. And this offensive line's good enough with these tailbacks to run the football.
Brett Taylor will take it inside the 10, plenty enough for the first down for Florida.
Big block by Jeff Mitchell, 71, the left guard. And Steve Spurrier is having it all his way here early in this ball game.
Florida offense is inside the 20, 20 possessions, 18 touchdowns and a field goal. Taylor breaks off the tackle at the 5-yard line, and he'll finally be stopped down at the 3. And let's check in with Mike Tirico.
As the Gators threaten, you know Florida fans always want to keep an eye on the Seminoles. They just ran one in. Zach Crockett up the middle, 24-yard score, his third of the season. Florida State scored on its first two possessions.
That road could be traveled many times tonight.
All those Florida teams, they score like basketball teams.
We'll see that Florida State club next week against North Carolina. Right here, it's 7-0, Gators lead. And they are knocking on the door again to keep it on the ground. And Taylor's going to be stopped maybe a gain of a half yard as a flag comes into the pile. Steve White, one of the first defenders to make contact.
Tennessee's got 12 men on the field, it looks like. Talking about basketball, there are 78 Division I basketball teams that average less points than Florida has averaged in their first two football games. And some pretty good basketball teams. Marquette, with Kevin O'Neill, his team averaged less than 71. Of course, a lot of success in Tennessee's basketball team, less than 71 points.
So it's second and goal. They fake the pitch and a great defensive play by Shane Burton, who will knock him down for a loss, and they will say back at the 6-yard line.
Ron, as I'm watching this game unfold, you have to think if you're the offensive coaches of Tennessee, you cannot allow your defense to stay on this field like they are. This defense has been on the field a long time here in the first quarter. Florida, Shane Burton with a big play. I just had to be a mix-up with Terry Dean on that play.
Third down, goal to go for Florida. Three wide receivers come left. Knocked down at the line of scrimmage, it's Burton again.
Gene Burton, number 84. See the pressure. They got Ben Talley sticking up there as a linebacker, and Florida decided they felt he was going to come, so they blocked down, left Gene Burton open on the outside to come through to knock down the pass.
Field goal attempt squarely in the middle of the field. 23-yard attempt. He's got it. So with 45 seconds left to play in this opening quarter, our new score, Florida 10 and Tennessee nothing. Don't forget, coming up next, immediately following this ball game at 9:30 Eastern time or thereabouts, number 10 against number 7, Wisconsin, travels to Boulder to do battle with the Colorado Buffaloes. Barry Alvarez leading his Badgers in this top 10 matchup tonight. That ought to be an awfully, awfully good ball game, Mike.
Well, who do you like in that football game?
Colorado, because they play so well at home. But I think it'll be a bang-up physical contest, because that's the kind of football that Wisconsin likes to play. I think you'll find those two lines, both offensively and defensively, that Colorado has two of the best in the country.
I'm going to go against you on that game, because I just think this Wisconsin team, battle-tested, had a lot of success last year, tough physical football team. I look for them to go out there and try to play the run game and have some success against Colorado. Ron, total yards. Florida has 182 total yards. Tennessee 34. That's what I'm saying. Tennessee has to generate some offense and get some first downs back to back.
Billy Williams and Nilo Sylvan are walking around nervously as Edge is about to kick it off. They know that they need to make something big happen here to get this crowd going again. This is Sylvan. Tries to get outside. Here comes the marker in, and now a second. We're going to have a clip. up around the 25-yard line, and it was Jackson defensively. Dimitri Jackson for Florida on the special teams. Well, Jimmy Harper's microphone having a little problem with that, but with all the rain and everything we've had tonight, not surprising. What do you think about the performance so far of Todd Helton?
I think so far they're having a problem running the football, which I thought they would against this front. So they came out, tried to open up with a little short passing game, 2 out of 4, 32 yards. They have to find a way to run the football. And I think they have to try the left side of their offensive line, the right side of Florida's defensive line. Ellis Johnson, Kevin Carter, too tough over here.
Well, they took your advice. Stewart, he'll take it for 3 very tough yards out to close to the 19-yard line. Kevin Mays, one of the blockers over there on that side. In his interview day before yesterday, Mays, who is the only senior on the offensive front, said, you know, when you play these guys, it doesn't matter if you're playing in the street or in the briar patch. He said, this will be headgear to headgear and really a tough rivalry.
This has become the rivalry like Auburn was with Tennessee.
No doubt about it. That's the end of the first quarter. With our score, the Florida Gators 10, the Tennessee Volunteers 10 to nothing. The Florida Gators at the end of the first 15 minutes. Mike, maybe Larry Marmee's worst fears. They got dominated in that first quarter.
Well, they did get dominated, but he's not getting any help from the Tennessee offense. They have to keep the defense off the field.
So the Florida Gators, as we open the second quarter, on defense. And so far, Todd Helton has not been able to find a key to unlock the safe against that defensive unit. Straight ahead with the running play. Now a marker comes down as James Stewart with the biggest rushing play of the night for Tennessee. And also picking up the first down, but let's go back and check that flag. And the Volunteers are taking a walk back. And let's check in quickly with Mike Tirico. Mike?
Ron, Alex Smith, good-looking freshman running back, 343 yards already on the season, finishes off a blocked punt. With this 9-yard touchdown run, Indiana has the lead in the Battle of the Bourbon Barrel. You'll see Indiana and Wisconsin next Saturday, right after College Game Day.
Okay, Mike, the numbers in this Florida with 182 and Tennessee with 40. Play action by Helton. Flag goes down. Pass overthrown. Boy, he had Kent open, and he just missed him, Mike, and now there's a flag deep in the secondary.
You would think it's holding on Florida here in the secondary from where the flag was thrown. See if we can pick it up. Todd Helton with an excellent ball fake here. Faked the ball. Now the ball's thrown behind the receiver, but again, it looked like Joey Kent, number 11, may have been held in the secondary.
Penalties for the ball game so far, 4 against Florida for 20, Tennessee 5 for 34. Pitch to Stewart, and he will be hit before he gets to the line of scrimmage. It's Kevin Carter, the big senior out of Tallahassee.
I think I'd stay away from that side for a while if I was Tennessee, because Kevin Carter and Ellis Johnson own the line of scrimmage. There's a toss sweep, but you just see there's nothing there. Kevin Carter, 57's off the football, makes the tackle.
So it's third down, and the line to make is the 23-and-a-half-yard line. This running play across the 15 out to the 17 as Kevin Freeman is there to make the stop. And as you can hear, some scattered boos from the faithful as they would like to see this offense get rolling.
And they're in a position now with Florida having a 10-0 lead. They can gamble a little bit on special teams and try to come up the middle and block a punt.
Hutton waits for the snap at the 3-yard line. Florida 10, Tennessee nothing. Early going second quarter. Great coverage kick, very high. Palmer at the 41, and he'll take it into the boundary and stop the clock with 13:11 left until halftime. So let's take a break with him. Florida on top, back in a moment. Tennessee cheerleaders trying to get some momentum going for their team. They're down 10-0 early going of this second quarter. And here are the numbers which tell you exactly why. 182-44. Williams, the tailback, out in the pattern as pressure is on. Now a flag comes down in a second. And Dean got whacked out of bounds. Duff was in pursuit along with Ben Talley.
There's a marker on the play.
The two flags that were thrown looked as though that they were thrown in the area where offensive holding would be called.
Ron, first down is a big down for both these teams tonight. You have to establish first down and at least get 4+ yards on first down. Winning on first down, Florida has 5 out of 8 4+ yards. That gives you a second and third down to play around with. Tennessee's 1 for 4. That means you're going to be in long yardage situations in second and third down. The percentages are against you.
By the way, we just had a report from the Tennessee locker room. Raymond Austin, the defensive back, did bruise his shoulder, but he should return this hand.
Well, where that hurts Tennessee is they can't bring in the extra defensive backs. They got too many hurt.
First down and long. Florida sets the screen. Elijah Williams has a path on the outside. Hurdles a man at the 35, and he's out to the 42-yard line. Raymond Austin, who we were just talking about, back in the lineup and is out to assist on the stop.
Ron, first down, and when you have first and 25, a good call is a screen or a little short pass over the middle just to get enough back where you get second and 11, second and 12. You don't want to try to get it all back on first down because they're playing heavy coverage against you. Here's the no back set again, which Tennessee likes to blitz.
16 yards in that last play. Dean steps up, throws it low, and has it complete, and not enough as Dorian makes the reception.
Four-man rush. If you can get pressure with four people, that helps. Try to collapse the pocket so that Terry Dean does not have any place to move up inside.
Third down, Florida. Pass deep over the middle, complete at the 25-yard line to Hilliard. Scott Galen made the stop, but Mike, that's not the matchup you're looking for with a linebacker on a wide receiver, and that's what they got.
Ike Hilliard, number 19, was lined up. No back set again. Terry Dean's going to look at the match that you just talked about, a linebacker versus a speedy wide receiver, and you'll take that every day with you the offense.
On first down, the ball is tipped, and it is still caught by Jackson. Inside the 10, at the 5, touchdown Florida. Now a flag comes down for celebration against Florida. Sportsmanlike conduct is the call for the celebration against Florida.
One-on-one situation. Jack Jackson with just a hitch slides to the outside. Ronald Davis, number one, went for the interception. Saw the ball was tipped. Aubrey Hill, number 82, with a key block. Touchdown, Florida. Just can't seem to stop him.
Davis with the extra point, and he knocks it home. And with 11:26 left in this first half, Florida 17-0. The Tennessee secondary going over strategy on the sideline. But Mike, Florida has already fired a lot of salvos, and they have had direct hits with a number of them. And the numbers show 4 plays, 55 yards. 22-yard touchdown pass, and look at those numbers, 196 yards already by Florida.
Total domination, and if you're watching across the country, we've seen Nebraska, we've seen some pretty good football teams. I haven't seen a better football team in Florida the first quarter here and part of the second quarter. Now, complete football team, good kicking game, sound on defense, strong defensive line, which I think you win with, and an offense is pretty tough to stop.
Edge kicks off from his own 20 because of that unsportsmanlike penalty. Sylvan from the 18-yard line will take it all the way across the field. Tries to turn the corner, and there's not much there. He'll be bumped out just across the 30. And Mike Adamley, what do you have for us? What have you seen down there?
Well, Ron, one of the things that Coach Fulmer talked about yesterday was the need to be successful early. It is no longer early. Florida leads 17-0. His biggest athlete thought, the crowd here at Neyland Stadium, they are quiet by their standards. Florida has negated them, and then the defensive secondary. I won't say that they are in disarray, but they are depleted, and it is limiting the number of coverages that Larry Marmee can use against Florida's pass offense.
Good observation, Mike. Plus the fact they got to get something out of this unit. They need the offense to stay on the field for a while. Kelton runs for his life, and that one is a one-hopper.
Ron, you see who's chasing him? Number 61, Ellis Johnson. He's 6'3", 283. Kevin Carter's also after him. They can't block the left side of the Florida defensive line. They're having a lot of trouble with Carter and Ellis Johnson. Just a complete fake here by Todd Helmich. You see right there, there's no faking. There's no stopping Ellis Johnson and Kevin Carter. They have to find a way to control them, and maybe a screen back to the side, a draw play, something to slow those two defenders down.
Hilton fumbles the snap and swings the pass off. This is Hayden. Aaron, nice move to the inside, takes it across the 40, and that is a very big Tennessee first down.
Big play, the backup tailback out of Detroit. Aaron Hayden, 6'2", 214. Todd Helton really made this play. Fumbled the snap, was able to get it back. Throw the ball out there, and Hayden pick up a key first down because they try to get this crowd back in the football game.
13 yards on that pass play. Helton bobbled it. It bounced once. He picked it up nicely. As we mentioned last week, he's a baseball player and a very good one. So very calmly picked it up and threw the completion. Quick out near sideline. Has it complete across midfield to Moe Stillings.
Pass complete to Moe Stillings.
When you have a defensive line that is fast trying to get to the quarterback, then you go to a little quick passes, a little five-step drop here. You see pretty good protection. Jeff Smith, number 74, Leslie Ratliff, number 75. Good quick pass out to Moe Phillip out of the backfield.
Hayden gets absolutely nothing. It's Dexter Daniels from his inside linebacking spot is there to stuff that one.
Dexter Daniels was a USA Player of the Year 3 years ago out of high school, Valdosta High School. You see how tough and how seven people are in the box. Ben Hanks, number 11, is the outside backer that keeps disguising outside, inside, trying to give him the seventh guy. Dexter Daniels, 16 tackles, one interception this season.
Third down, and they need a yard and a half. Helton, pass overthrown, looking for Phillips. Hanks was there, one of the first men. Also, Keeter Malone.
You talk about respect for a defense. Third and two, and you have a great running game, and you're throwing the football on third and two. That is the respect for the Florida defense that Tennessee has.
So Hutton has been a busy man. His football team down 7-0 as we have 9:54 left until halftime. And again, it's Palmer back in a single safety for the Gators. Kicks it away from Palmer. It will go inside the 10 and now down at the 5-yard line. 43 yards on the punt. And the offensive line in Mr. Helton, ponder, what can we get going? Nothing, Florida leading the Tennessee Volunteers. You can see we have 9:42 left until halftime as the Florida band plays the ESPN theme, which we appreciate greatly. And now here comes Rocky Top. Mike, these people are such loyal, I mean, they are great fans. They are unaccustomed to seeing particularly a good football team like this being held the way they have been held and stopped in this first half of play.
They've been dominated here in the first quarter and a half.
I think the team is in shock and so are the fans. Good open field stop by Jason Parker on Williams. Elijah tried to take a high step over him and he caught him by the ankle. No, the numbers, Dean, 12 of 15, 196 yards, one touch, one interception. And for Todd Helton, 4 of 8, 53 yards, and no touchdowns, no interceptions.
The difference being, Florida's run the football successfully.
Just what you said off the top of the telecast, huh? Williams. There's a couple of tough yards right there. As Mike mentioned, Elijah Williams is not the biggest of the tailbacks, but very, very shifty at 5'10", 178. But Fred Taylor, the other freshman out of Belgrade, is 6'1", 214, and possesses maybe not quite as much open field pizzazz, but he's got some wiggle, but he is much bigger.
Ron, Elijah Williams averaged 10.5 yards a carry in high school, but only ran the ball 9 times a game, so he was relatively an unknown. But the Florida coaches watched him in the Monday scrimmages when they had the young player scrimmage, and they knew he was going to be special.
Dean on play action has a hand in his face. That was Leland Taylor. Now he's going to run it, and he'll take it out of bounds just across the 20-yard line. George Kidd will get credit for the play, but also credit Leland Taylor for stopping that forward pass from being thrown where he wanted it. And Mike Adamley, what do you have?
Well, Ryan, one of the things the defensive line coach of Tennessee was instructing his troops during practice this week regarding Terry Dean, they realized that he scrambled well. A lot of the successful passes came off the scramble. The thing he preached, don't leave your feet. That's exactly what Leland Taylor did. Terry got outside.
Yep, he sure did. Probably Hill in motion to the bottom of the screen, and they'll keep it on the ground. Look at Williams. Breaks one, breaks two, caught by the ankle, and they're going to give him progress to the 30-yard line. Not enough for the first down, but there's a running play that gets 8 on first, and Jason Parker is the one who grabbed his shoelaces.
First down, you get 8 yards, you're second and 2, now you get the run pass option. Inside line of scrimmage, you see how they dominate the Tennessee front. A missed tackle by number 93, Scott Gallion. You can't, as a middle linebacker, miss that play.
And a short yardage play close to the first down. It's Trey Teague, a reserve right defensive tackle, who makes the stop on Elijah Williams. And we have been told that in the early going of the ballgame as we went to the second quarter, that Tennessee, in trying to get rest, had played every starter and backup on the defensive front already, Mike.
Well, you remember, they lost all 4 defensive line starters from last year, so this is a young defensive line. Now you take the injuries in the secondary, you're taking a defensive football team that's hurt a little bit. Florida knows that, and you don't want to smell blood a little bit, and Florida's going to come after you.
It's also a defensive line that accounted for 22 sacks. That's 2 a ball game from just your down folks. That is very good production. So it's third down. Third down and just inches. Dean will have it straight ahead. David Swain, the center, just submarined, and the senior from Altamont Springs was with his quarterback right behind him, and he'll pick up the first down.
Ron, Steve Spurrier said the last 2 times he was here at Tennessee, they just didn't protect their offensive line. Chuck Smith, Chris Mims, Todd Kelly were defensive players for Tennessee. They never touched, but he feels like this is the best line he's had since he's been in college football.
It's the zone play again, Mike, that you have talked about, where the running back takes it, plants a foot, wherever there's an opening, he can either go left or bring it back to the right, and that time there was nothing.
Well, it makes it look like it's going to be a pitch to the left side, so you get the linebackers to take a step, and then you get your offensive linemen to get a little bit of an angle on them, and then with some speed to come back to the backside, but Tennessee read it, played it very well.
Rain beginning to fall again here at Knoxville. Pressure on Dean. He gets collapsed on as the ball is thrown. And now here's a late flag and a second one.
Larry Marmy, the defensive coordinator, with his bag of tricks, just trying to find some way to slow him down.
Offensive interference. It's no penalty. The pass was not catchable. It's third down.
Okay, so you could hear the call from Jimmy Harper's. Take a look at the hit on the quarterback, Dean. He really gets benched back. Boy. It's offensive pass interference, but the ball was not catchable. Third down, and again, the no back set. Over the middle, it is caught for the first down by Doring. How in the world did he get between the two defensive backs? He does, and Florida will move the chains.
Ron, by going to this formation, here's what Florida, the advantages Florida has. Chris Doering, the inside receiver, you see him, he's against the linebacker right here. He's just going to work down the field. He's not open long, but just enough in the window of a zone defense. See the linebacker, Scott Gallion, and everybody collapses on him. Raymond Austin, the safety, but he was open for that second in the window. Terry Dean with the football.
First down across midfield. Play action. Looking long, going to go on top. He wants Jack Jackson at the end zone. It is tipped and knocked away. Good job by Jason Parker, one of the two defenders, along with Sean Summers, a junior out of Oak Ridge.
But Ron, that ball has to be intercepted. You know, he's back. Jason Parker's back there, but doesn't come up with the interception. He stopped too soon. In a couple passes against Georgia last week, he underplayed them. The defensive backs talking about that should have had interceptions. That should have been an interception for Tennessee. Here's the fake. No one's faked in the secondary, but you're going to see this ball's hanging up there. That ball should have been picked off.
Blitz from the secondary. The ball is in the flat, and it's Elijah Williams. He gets a block. 20, 15. Tackled inside the 10. Fumbles. Still loose. Florida football at the 1. Dwayne Mobley, number 23, made the recovery. And Phil Fulmer is saying, how in the world can we get a break?
Ron, you have a scramble rule. When the quarterback scrambles, the receivers, you scramble with him in the same direction. Elijah Williams moved right with the quarterback. Caught the football, then coughed it up. Almost a recovery by Scott Gallion, number 93. Wayne Mobley, number 23 for Florida, recovers the football.
So that's a 46-yard play. First and goal, Florida. Elijah Williams, left side, he'll walk in.
Dwayne Mobley, number 23, comes right back after he recovered the fumble, gets a good block, touchdown Florida, and I'd like to see the total number of plays right now. Florida offensively has just dominated the football game. Tennessee's ability to stop them and also move the football on offense. This has been a one-sided effort by Florida. A very impressive first half by the Gators.
Wow. I mean, we're not talking about a run-of-the-mill football team in Tennessee. Judd Davis with the extra point attempt. It's good, and it's 24-0 with 5:10 left until halftime. Well, now for our Sega Students of the Game, for the Florida Gators, senior safety Michael Gilmore. He's majoring in zoology. He's a pre-med and has a 3.7 GPA. And for Tennessee, senior punter Tom Hutton. He is majoring in public relations and has a 3.0 GPA. Sega congratulates these fine student athletes.
and have just been handed. Florida's had 34 plays on offense, Tennessee 15. Ron, you mentioned something interesting earlier. I know as a football coach, when you go away and the crowd is against you, you noticed the Florida band here, and I think that was a key move by Florida. Of course, the band can't play now. They're not going to catch a football, but it's important when you got somebody there pulling for you.
You know, Mike, and the reason I made the point, I can remember in a huge game between Texas and Auburn in 1983 when Fred Akers and his staff asked if they would send a band. It's very expensive to send a large unit that far, just as it is to come up here to Knoxville. But the coaches feel as though that it is worth that much extra fame. Nobody can argue with the results so far tonight. Billy Williams outside on the right. And finally stopped at around the 25-yard line by Jackson. Mike Adamly, what do you have for us?
Well, Ron, Coach Fulmer got off the funniest line of the week when he said we couldn't score 70 points against air. Brings to mind something Steve Spurrier had to deal with this week. Questions about running up the score, which I think is ridiculous. Number one, the Gators are gunning after a national championship. And from a player's perspective, number two, if I'm the third string tailback, I'm going to try to score every time I touch the ball. If Florida is guilty of anything, it's having an abundance of talent and depth.
Mike, I got to disagree with you. 70 points is too many. That's my feeling. I know everybody says let them play and all of it. 70 is too much.
Whoa, what a hit. Courtney Epps on the receiving end. Lawrence Wright with the hit, and as you can see, Epps is still down. By the way, that drive a moment ago, 12 plays, 94 yards, 4 minutes and 32 seconds is what Florida used.
I guess it's because when I coached, I couldn't get a team to score 70 points, but I just think that's too many. I just feel like there's a way of slowing it down. Now, I grant you, I agree with what Mike says. You don't want to tell a guy you can't score, you can't do this, but there's ways, and I've been on that other side when I've gotten beat by close to 70. It's no fun.
Yeah, there's a fine line there somewhere, Michael, and last week, for instance, he's playing third and even fourth stringers and walk-ons in the third and fourth quarter. One of their touchdown passes caught by a senior walk-on, Phil Bowen, for a touchdown. So it's a tough call.
Jason Parker, one of the defensive backs for the Tennessee Volunteers, pacing on the sideline. This is extremely hard on any football team. Not his, of course, but Phil Fulmer's football team comes home finally for the first time. They have played two very tough games on the road. First in the Rose Bowl against a good UCLA team. Then they have to go between the hedges last week to play a conference game against Georgia. Never easy a place to play down there. They come up with some injuries, but still they finally get to get back home. And then all of a sudden, you come into a ball game, you're a little off stride, you're still playing with a new quarterback. And I mean, this Florida team, buddy, they come in, and these are not just jabs they're throwing. I mean, these are crosses.
They're getting hit by a train.
Whoa, I'm telling you. I mean, this, I think even
the
Tennessee
Chattanooga
players.
Choo-choo either. I'll tell you, they're getting hit.
Tennessee players look stunned that they are being handled this way. Stewart runs into his own man. Mark Campbell is the man who forced it. Number 67, a junior out of Miami.
We talked about 200 rushing yardage for Tennessee, and there's something like 38-1-1. They have not been able to establish the run against this Florida defense. They will not allow them to run the football. They want Todd Helton to throw in the 25 to 30 passes, and they feel they can win it. But if they allow Tennessee to run the ball, then they feel like Tennessee has a shot at him.
Pass near sideline, has it complete to Joey Kent, and that is across midfield and should be enough for the Tennessee first down.
Ron, I talked a couple weeks ago. I said Warren Sapp from Miami is the leading candidate for a lot of the lineman awards, and Kevin Carter. Add Ellis Johnson, number 61, to your voting list. This guy plays with a motor the whole game. He's a tough pass rusher, and he anchors in on the running game. Forced a pass here, but a good throw by Todd Helton to Joey Kent. I know you vote for the Lombardi. Put Ellis Johnson in your voting.
Not a bad ballot with his name on it, would it be? Pelton's going to run. He'll take it inside the 40 to the 38-yard line, and it's Darren Hambrick along with Dexter Daniels on the stop.
You know, as Todd Helton runs the football, we talked last week about him being a baseball player. A lot of people think he'd be the number one baseball pick. And they tell pro baseball scouts tell me that every game he starts at Tennessee, his negotiation goes up $100,000 because he'll say, I'm not going to play baseball. I'll go back to Tennessee and be the quarterback.
It's the longest Tennessee rush, that 8-yard gain just now. Here's Stewart. Tries to get it going to the left side. Close to the first down, but I don't think he's going to have it. Don't forget, coming up immediately after this game, we'll take you to Boulder, Colorado, at a top 10 matchup between the Wisconsin Badgers and the Buffaloes of Colorado. Third down, Tennessee. Inches is what they need. Helton's going to have it. Hear the reaction from the crowd as the first down is noted. 2:37 until intermission time. Tennessee down 24 to nothing. Helton going to give him progress inside the 30. The clock continues to run. It's Mark Campbell on the stop. Here's a really good story. This kid from Jamaica was a soccer player, runs a 4.7, and they have him playing at defensive end. His home is Miami, but Mike, 6'3", 287 pounds, and he's a junior.
And they say his football is ahead of him. He's a young guy that didn't play much high school football.
Mike, he doesn't look a lot like a soccer player, though. I know that's what the bio says.
Goalie.
Let's take a timeout. The goal, the entire goal.
2:10 left until halftime. We'll be right back. Florida 24 to nothing with 2:10 left in the second quarter. Coming up at halftime, some of the things we'll be talking about. SEC barn burners, and also a live report from Lincoln, Nebraska, where the party should be going pretty well by now. Graham. Jay tries to get it to the right side, and he'll take it for a couple of yards. Here's a sophomore out of Kannapolis, North Carolina, and they have some big thoughts for him here at Tennessee.
Tennessee continues to try that right side of the line. Carter and Johnson.
Pressure, ball is caught. Billy Williams came away with it. They had two receivers right in the same area.
Excellent throw by Todd Helton. Again, the left-hander moving to his left is able to get a lot on that football. Rolling to the left side. Good coverage by Florida. Billy Williams is finding the little seam in there, makes the catch. Anthon Lott, number 9, with a tackle.
Pressure on Helton. And he'll be sacked at the 20. Ben Hanks, the junior out of Miami.
Talked to Ben Hanks, Florida, Thursday's practice, and he said that when he decided to go to the University of Florida, you see, his coaches said he was too laid back. Ron Zook, then the defensive coordinator, told him to get some pep in himself. I'll tell you what, he's got a lot of pep in himself right now. He's a good defensive linebacker, but also could be a defensive back in their scheme of things. Ron, they were a 4-4 defensive team last year, and Steve Spurrier said that the players lost faith in the system, not the coaches. You see Ron Zook right in front of Ben Hanks. He was the defensive coordinator. They brought in Bob Pruitt from Tulane to bring in the 4-3. Ron Zook unselfishly moved aside. Now he runs the special teams. You see him, how active he is. And you always talk to players about being a role player, that sometimes you have to start, sometimes you're a second teamer. Ron Zook has accepted that role and is coaching hard for Florida.
Well, His special team set the tone for this one tonight. A 60-yard kickoff return really kind of put a label on what kind of evening the Florida Gators were going to get off to. Second down, Tennessee. The line to make is the 7. For a moment, throwback screen in the middle. Wow, Joey Kent makes the catch, and then he gets annihilated by Mark Campbell. Campbell is amazing how well he runs for a larger person.
For a soccer player. He can move. He closed the seam. That quick screen, because of the speed of the Florida defense, closed quickly.
Clock running to under 1 minute.
You have to figure they have to try to find Billy Williams here. He's been the most successful receiver for Todd Helton.
Over the middle, has a man, and it is intercepted in the end zone by the Florida Gators as the pass was well overthrown by Helton.
Poorly thrown ball, Ron. Again, good pressure. Lawrence Wright, number 4. Michael Gilmore, number 35, sitting in center field.
Adamley, let's check in with you.
You know, we talked about Todd's exploits on the baseball field. He was telling me the mechanics of throwing a football and hurling a baseball, completely different set of muscles involved. And he said if he threw a wounded duck tonight, it would be because he was reverting back to his old baseball release. That was not a good pass.
And you can see Gilmore makes the pickoff. And with 32 seconds showing on the clock, certainly the best offensive venture of the night, but the balls goes astray. They're down 24 to nothing, and it looks as though that the Gators, as the play has now been whistled in, they will not have to run another one. They'll be able to head to halftime up by 3 touchdowns and a field goal. What an impressive first half for Florida. That's the end of the first 30 minutes. Gators 24, Tennessee nothing. Now stay tuned for the halftime report. Our score at halftime as Florida has dominated the first 30 minutes of play. And Mike Gottfried, off the top of the telecast, you said one thing. The team that can run the football is the one who is going to be ahead in this football game. Boy, is that ever true.
Total domination by Florida, Ron. Tennessee can't run the football, and that's their game. They have to be able to run the football. And you look at the total plays, 39 for Florida, 29 for Tennessee. But now look at the first down success, 8 for 14 Florida. To me, that's a key because second and third down, they get so many luxuries. 26 rushing yardage for Tennessee, a team that's noted for their running game.
Underway as Tennessee will get an opportunity to get some offense going. It's Billy Williams from the 1. Williams is not even going to make it to the 20-yard line. That's Riggins, Anthony Riggins, of the special teams for Florida.
You talked about the Tennessee offensive line. We were so impressed with them last week, but against this Florida defensive line, 10 of 17 attempts, 1.7 average inside against them. So they're running the football. They're not having any success. 1.5 outside. This is the best defensive front I've seen in college football this year, the Florida defensive front.
And you have seen Nebraska, haven't you?
I have seen Nebraska. Without a doubt, the first half of what I've seen here, Florida is the best team in the country of the teams that I've watched.
Billy Williams opens it up with a drop of a Todd Helton pass to open the second half.
First two games, 292.5 rushing yards tonight, just 26. Therein lies the story of this football game. That and the fact Florida's offense having their way with the Tennessee defense.
Option play. Boy, you could see Helton get taken out and his little man Stewart, and they finally get him open. The last time he had a big breaker, they got caught with a penalty. But this one will take it to the 33, and it's Lawrence Wright who makes the stop on a gain of 16. And, Mike, look at Mark Campbell take Helton out of the play.
Well, what Todd Helton with the option, that's like a pass. As he rolls to the side, he'll pitch the ball on the option. But that's like a pass play for this Tennessee offense. because now you have to play assignment football. Ben Hanks gets blocked, and now you're in the secondary. James Stewart, that's some success for Tennessee.
Nelson deep over the middle, overthrown, and he had Nilo Sylvan open. Mike Adamley, let's go to you.
Ron Franklin, that Billy Williams drop moments ago was indicative of Coach Fulmer's thoughts about the first half. He was more disappointed in his offense than his defense. He talked about getting little man James Stewart back into the mix and possibly, I don't know if he was being facetious or not, even going to a no-huddle offense to get something going.
Anything to shake it up. I can understand that, Michael. Bounces it outside, 40, 45, out to the 50-yard line. Ben Hanks finally makes the stop along with Andon Locke.
You know, when you go in the locker room at halftime and you've been thoroughly beaten in the first half like Tennessee is, you know Phil Fulmer and the coaches are going to try to get the attention of their football team. On the other side of the ball, Florida with a comfortable 24-0 lead, Steve Spurrier cannot allow his football team the luxury of coming out here and falling asleep.
And we've seen that thing fall momentum and see it reverse. First game this year we saw that, didn't we, Mike? Stewart causes a miss at the line of scrimmage and will take it down inside the 45 before Ellis Johnson will bring it down at the 42.
Now, this is the Tennessee running game that these fans are so accustomed to watching. Now what has to happen for Florida? Florida was playing pass as they started the second half with a 24-0 lead. Now they have to start trying to find somebody to get inside there to give them the seventh man in the box to try to slow this running game down.
Throws the pass again. Sylvan was open by 5 yards.
He started into a back pedal. He got too close to the sideline, and he lost his footing. Ball thrown high, but Nilo Sylvan started in a back pedal. You'll see him come out of this thing as a receiver. He's completely got his shoulder square back to the quarterback, and he just loses some footing. Ball a little high. Missed opportunity.
Aaron Hayden checks into the ball game at tailback for the Volunteers. Third down. They need the ball just inside the 38 of Florida. Option for the other side. Pitch is not there. It'll be picked up and recovered by Hayden at the 49-yard line.
Kevin Carter. Todd Helton got too close to Kevin Carter. Remember now, Todd Helton is a quarterback that's never been through spring football. He came into this season as a second-team quarterback. Didn't get a lot of snaps. You're going to see Carter, number 57, come down hard and make the hit on the option. Todd Helton gets too close to him to make the pitch.
Button's kicked to the far sideline. Palmer calls for the fair catch. And Cirillo makes it just inside the 15. So we'll take a break. 12:37 left in the third. Florida on top. To Neyland Stadium, Knoxville, Tennessee. Ron Franklin with Mike Godfrey and Mike Adamley. Our score 24-0. Tennessee trailing the Florida Gators. And the first time that Terry Dean and company have touched the ball in the second half.
Terry Dean's had his way with the Tennessee defense. Most of the completion has been in the 10 to 15 yard range. If you look at the middle, did go deep one time early in the ball game, which really changed field position. You see the three for three flare passes behind the line of scrimmage. So really a nice possession type passing game for Florida.
261 yards, one touchdown, one interception. That's the first for him this year, only the second for the team. Reverse to Jackson, back into the boundary, close to the first down. And they're going to give him forward progress, in fact, across the 25, and that would be enough.
Talk about systems all the time. Florida has a system. Offensively, the quarterback's going to work at a high rate of success because their system's so good. The quarterback knows what he's doing. He throws on time. When he takes his five steps, he throws the football. Knows where he's going with the football.
3 seconds down to two. He got it away, still in time. Backside pressure, he felt it, and now delivers it. And good heavens, Sean Nunn is tied in. Had just drifted behind everybody, and he overthrew it.
Good man coverage. Sean Nunn against the linebacker. George Kidd, number 42, with good rush on Terry Dean. He brought an outside linebacker, manned up in the coverage. See the tight end of Sean Nunn, number 80. Just no one there. Everybody felt like that the quarterback was going to be sacked. Gave up a little bit on coverage. Can't ever give up on Terry Dean because they've got a good scramble package and he's moving.
This one and has it incomplete. Nope, they're going to say complete and fumble recovery. Florida has made the recovery at the 34 by Sean Nunn.
Jason Parker really leveled Sean Nunn.
Phillip Fulmer's got to be saying, what do we have to do to get a break?
Well, I'll tell you what, that was an excellent hit there by Jason Parker, the safety.
Was complete. They had it loose on the turf, and then Florida came up to make the recovery. Much like the situation inside the goal line back in the first half, as you look at Jack Jackson. Blitz from the outside and hit in the backfield. That's George Kidd, number 42, on Elijah Williams. And that brings them to their feet here at Neyland Stadium. Since he came into this ball game at linebacker.
That was a big play because he was able to get under the block of the wide receiver and make the tackle on Elijah Williams before he even got out of the backfield.
Here's a quiz for you. This is the first punt.
Is that a question or an answer?
What,
quiz?
What you had a look on your face staring at, I was going to say, this is the first punt by Florida.
Line drive spotter, Sean Summers. At the 22-yard line. Blocked in the back, and that's the reason for the flag.
Ron, the Florida punter may be the most inexperienced player on this football team when the season ends because they score so much.
That's a good point.
That was clearly a block and a push in the back by Tennessee. So you're going to have to take a walk back.
Have an illegal block in the back during the return. This receiving team, first down.
Phillip Fulmer continues to seek something that can get a break against this Florida team. When you're down 24 to nothing, you need somebody to step up. Number 42, George Kidd, did on that series.
Kind of confused Florida a little bit. Here's a tight end, no one to block. There's George Kidd. He's going to come across the line of scrimmage and beat the block of the wide receiver. I think it was really a bust by Sean Nunn, number 80. Sean Nunn really should have went out and blocked George Kidd, but George Kidd came free.
Takes this one to Stewart. Throws it out in the flat. Hayden, and he will take it close to the 30. Kevin Freeman on that inside linebacking position to make the stop.
Talk about respect again for this Florida defense. Tennessee chooses to throw the ball, play action pass on first down. Good fake by Todd Helton. Out of the backfield came Aaron Hayden, number 24, against the linebacker. Came free on the right side.
Helton has it tipped. As the pass was thrown, he had Joey Kent open. I think Mo Phillips is the guy who's trying to throw it to.
Ron, I'm telling you, Ellis Johnson is destroying the offensive line and the offensive game plan of Tennessee. They double-teamed him on that play. He came through and put pressure on Todd Helton. You're talking about an impressive football player, number 61 for Florida, Ellis Johnson.
Third down conversion, 6 of 9 Florida, 2 of 8 Tennessee. Hayden wrapped up just as he gets to the line of scrimmage. It's Kevin Freeman who grabs a hold, and let's see where they say forward progress is. It appears that the linesman on this side would have it just across the 30. That is a first down.
Ellis Johnson, number 61, the left defensive tackle. moves down, gets across the block at Jeff Smith, 74, gets in on the tackle on Aaron Hayden. Never stopped. Was blocked by Jeff Smith, never stopped, kept moving to the football. Shoulder square, made the tackle on Aaron Hayden.
Jay Graham is coming to tailback. Ball tipped and caught. That's a good effort by Joey Kent. Not so sure that a pass interference should not have been called before the pass was caught because there was contact, but it was locked defensively.
Good ball by Todd Helton. He had something on this football. Todd Helton drilling the football to Joey Kent. You're right, Ron. Anthony Lott may have got there a little bit early and got away with one.
Probably didn't throw it because of Joey Kent making the reception. Going to be a second down, about 4.5. Big head of steam, has 5, has 10. Jay Graham across the 45 and down to the 43-yard line. Ball came loose. The officials say the play is dead. 21 yards in the carry.
Good block by Jeff Smith. Ellis Johnson's not in on this play. He's replaced by David Barnard, number 97, took advantage of that. Here comes 061 back in the ballgame, oh.
Gilmore had to finally help put a stop on him. Longest rush of the night by the Tennessee Volunteers. Play action, help. Complete at the 42, Billy Williams being pushed back. I beg your pardon, the 37-yard line. And Billy will take it to the 35.
Larry Kennedy on the tackle.
Larry Kennedy was shaken up just a little bit. We continue to remind you, but we don't want you to forget. Coming up next, from Boulder, Colorado, Wisconsin, number 10, against number 7, Colorado. Graham, play action to him. Going to go for the end zone. Williams is there and just overthrown. Get a good look at Larry Kennedy coming up, and he injured that hand not on this pass play but the play just prior to that.
You're looking at two downs to make this first down. Gotta pick this first down up.
Helton straight ahead with the quarterback sneak, and looks like he's going to have it right off the block of Bubba Miller.
Something interesting about the Florida defensive players, Ron. In their first two ball games, they only played 30 plays in the New Mexico State game and 30 plays in the Kentucky game. So they're not used to playing in the third quarter. They're usually dressed in a hot dog by now.
Good point. Fourth down. Did not pick it up. Inches. There you can see it.
Didn't get much of a spot on that last play.
No, they sure didn't, Mike. Over the top, James Stewart will have the first down for the Vols. Mark Campbell on the bottom. Well, Tennessee had a good drive going. Had a good drive going on their opening possession here in the second half, and then things petered out on. Now they got another one going right here. And Mike, I would have to think that as far as Todd Helton is concerned, that if they don't come up with some kind of points or have success here, then a huge decision by Philip Fulmer. I think he's got to decide if he's going to put in one of the freshmen.
We'll get into that. I look for an option here to the left side.
Hit in the backfield is Hayden, and he is going to be pushed back for a loss of about 3. That is Darren Hamber. Also Stewart. Peyton Manning, of course, son of Archie Manning. Brandon Stewart out of Stephenville, Texas, guided that team to a state championship last year. Both highly touted and sought after, both decided to come to Tennessee.
Ron, Darren Hambrick, who made that last play, his uncle was Jim Mudcat Grant, pitcher for the Cleveland Indians, and really a well-liked player in that Cleveland area.
Well, Elkin. Out of harm's way for a moment. Now is knocked down. Loses the football. And Florida has recovered at the 47-yard line. Johnny Church.
Henry McMillan, number 60, with the pressure, caused the fumble. Todd Helton, you have to really credit that to the secondary of Florida, because there really wasn't any place to go with the football. Darren Hambrick, number 42, is in his way. Johnny Church, number 40. Mark Campbell, going to see McMillan, number 60, strip the football. Johnny Church, number 40, recover, and Florida's in business again.
Running play, big opening for Taylor. Inside the 45, and he is down to the Tennessee 41-yard line.
You bring up an interesting point about the freshman quarterbacks as you look at the defensive line of Florida. To me, this is the strength of this football team. When you have six defensive linemen like they do, they have six defensive linemen who will probably play in the pros, but Philip Fulmer does have a decision as we go along down to 5:20 here in the third quarter. It's not the kind of game you'd like to bring a freshman in, because you're not controlling the line of scrimmage, and you could get them so that they're not really want to be on that football field.
Taylor is hit by Steve White. That'll be short yardage.
I believe I'd go with Todd Helton one more series and see if he could get something done and put it together, and then maybe call on the freshman as you get into the fourth quarter.
Peyton Manning, we visited with his dad on the sideline last week at Athens.
And he considered Florida for a long time in the recruiting process.
He was visiting briefly there with Bubba Miller, the offensive center.
Expecting a blitz here.
Wow. Dean scrambles and just throws it away. Throws a very safe pass. Did have a receiver who was breaking open, but rather than take a chance on the pickoff, just threw it short. Well, we understand that over on the sideline that Peyton Manning is taking snaps from Bubba Miller.
Yep.
Really, when you don't have spring practice as a quarterback, he's been here 3 years and never practiced in spring practice, really hurts you.
Flag comes down.
Five-yard penalty.
Well, don't forget, tomorrow at noon Eastern time, NFL Game Day, examine the surprising 2-0 start of the New York Jets under their new head coach. And also look at the intense rivalry between the Raiders and the Broncos. Then 7 o'clock tomorrow night, NFL primetime. Join Chris Berman, Robin Roberts, and Tom Jackson for wall-to-wall highlights. All tomorrow, right here on ESPN.
This formation, they've worked to the wide side of the field. Look for him to come back to short side here.
5 yards on the substitution violation. Now a flag comes into the pile, and the pass overthrown. Aubrey Hill is the man he wanted. It was Jesse Sanders who was applying the pressure. And the reason that Coach Spurrier is upset, this is in the area. Yep, it's going to be offensive holding. The one thing that has not gone really well for Florida. Penalty decline, and again, we're having problems with Jimmy Harper's microphone. Florida has been highly, highly penalized this year, averaging over 10 penalties a ball game.
I tell you, you could penalize them 20 times, you wouldn't slow them down, because that's not hurting. They're averaging 70 points in the first two games, and they're off here 24-0 against a good Tennessee team.
Shane Edge will come on to kick it away for the Gators. As you see Manning on the phone on the sidelines, and we would assume that he will come on to direct the Tennessee offense on this next series. Sean Summers. Good high coverage kick as Summers runs away from it, bounds at the 5 and goes into the end zone. We'll take a break. 4:05 left in this third quarter. Florida 24, Tennessee nothing. Carlian 6'5", 207. Played just briefly in the UCLA game. Did not play last week against Georgia. his numbers at Newman High School in New Orleans. And a throw on first down. Zips it out and has it complete. Little man Stewart at the 25-yard line. Ben Hanks is there to take the feet out from under him.
Just that little pass play where he fakes the ball to the tailback, James Stewart. He's going to go right against the linebacker, slide to the right side, little safe pass to get Peyton Manning off the mark. Ben Hanks on the tackle.
Pick screen, Billy Williams across the 30. 35 and close to the 40-yard line. Gilmore rides him up.
Fans always like the second-team quarterback. Peyton Manning with a fake here. Another good play action. Just holding the linebackers and then throws the ball out in the flat on the quick screen. Billy Williams, 2 for 2 on two quick throws.
I think they're going to like him for a long time, though, Mike, and I don't think he's going to be second-team.
No, but you got an interesting quarterback situation because you got another freshman over there, Brandon Stewart, that's highly recruited also.
Awfully good. You're right. Zings it incomplete.
When you have a freshman quarterback in the game, Bob Pruitt, the defensive coordinator, is going to try to stunt and try to bring some people against him. Ben Hanks, number 11, as you see Brandon Stewart. There's Todd Helton. So now when this happens, you get a little bit of a quarterback dilemma. Now you got to play your way on the field. All bets are off now who the starter is.
Helton, 11 of 21, 124 yards and one interception. Also lost a fumble. Over the middle to Stewart, and he will take it to the 47-yard line.
Little safe dinkum passes where they're just throwing the ball 5 yards, trying to control the football. Little throw again to James Stewart. The success Tennessee's had throwing the football has been to the running back, James Stewart. Peyton Manning with the ball just over the middle to number 33, James Stewart.
Third down balls. They need the 50. Zings it, almost intercepted by Kennedy, and his receiver had run it up. Obviously, a miscommunication.
Well, you're going to have that with a freshman. He's only been here for about 4 weeks, so you're going to have some miscommunication along the way. And somewhere there's a father who's very nervous. I believe they're down in Tampa, New Orleans playing, and I think he works the radio. So you got a nervous father somewhere in Florida. Archie Manning watching his son play tonight, and Phil Fulmer's going to go for it on fourth down.
Hayden, the lone setback. Fourth down, Tennessee. Going to be sacked back at the 31-yard line by Kevin Carter.
Ron, that's the freshman in a quarterback when he's only been here for 4 weeks. He's taking the sack, Kevin Carter, all the way back to the 32-yard line, and Florida now in great field position. Just wasn't anything open for Peyton Manning. Drop back, looking, trying to get rid of the football, trying to buy some time. Kevin Carter, Leslie Ratliff trying to block, but there's number 57, Kevin Carter.
Loss of 16 on the play, and the Gators will begin this one at the Tennessee 31. Know that offensive line, it says volumes as far as the job they have had. Maybe I should say the task that they have had against the Florida defense. Well, let's take a break. 24 to nothing. Florida leads. We'll be right back. .229 left in this third quarter. Florida and Tennessee. Nobody has scored in this third stanza. That's how we were at halftime.
I don't think you're going to be able to say that much longer. You know, they're with the field position they have, capable in one play.
Eli Elijah Williams is the lone setback. Ball is fumbled. They give it to Williams. Runs into his own blocker, and then just on good individual effort, will get it back to the line of scrimmage.
Tennessee committing safeties now to try to put some pressure on Florida on first down. Elijah Williams, number 25, gets a late handoff. Jason Parker, the free safety, up to make the tackle.
Take the draw over the middle, has it complete to Aubrey Hill. He got smacked pretty good, but that'll be plenty enough for the first down. First down plus five.
Good fake by Terry Dean. And when you fake the ball and you take some pride in your ball handling, watch the linebackers, because the linebackers after the fake here are held just enough that Aubrey Hill, number 82. See, the linebackers, they're stuck now, and there's no depth at all out of the linebackers, and the seam in between the safety wide open for Florida.
Parker came up and tagged him. Blitz coming from the Volunteer. Looking for the end zone touchdown here. Almost stepped on Smokey in the process.
Smokey feels like he's been stepped on tonight. And you blitz him, that's what happens. They've got a fine oiled machine here. They waited for the blitz. Aubrey Hill one-on-one. They brought a safety out of the backfield, Raymond Austin. And when you're behind, you've got to send safeties. You've got to blitz. And Florida likes the fact that you're going to try to blitz them.
Finally, you can see a little bit of a smile from Steve Spurrier. He's never won in this stadium as the head coach at Florida. He did win here as the head coach at Duke, but not with the Gators. But boy, he is well on the way tonight. And not just a win, but a convincing win. 31-0. Well, Thursday evening, 7:30 Eastern Time, the weekend kickoff show for previews and predictions of next weekend's college football matchups, then followed by West Virginia at Virginia Tech. Virginia Tech led by that great quarterback, Maurice DeShazo. They will host their neighboring rivals, West Virginia and Virginia Tech, next Thursday.
I watched Virginia Tech on TV today. I was very impressed with Frank Beamer's football team. They've got a good, solid defense, and Maurice DeShazo gives you an option pass-type quarterback. They were impressive today in their win over Boston College.
Secondary for Tennessee. Kind of says a lot as far as the sigh and the lean back on the bench of Jason Parker.
Playing a little shorthanded in the secondary with all those injuries.
Injuries and illness.
I believe it's taken them out a lot of their coverages. Just a tough night. Deron Jenkins got hurt against Georgia and is not in the ball game.
You can have all your hands, and this Florida team can make you look bad. And when you come to the table, not all your cards, the game may not last as
long
as
you want.
I'll
tell you what, Ron, their schedule, they're looking at being 10-0 when they get to Florida State.
And to bring it to the 20, let's check in with Mike Adamley. Mike?
Ron and Mike, with everybody conjecturing who the number two quarterback is, Coach Phil Fulmer told us that decision won't be made until 1995. To wit, the next series is going to be taken by Brandon Stewart, not Peyton Manning. We'll see how he'll do.
This is exactly the rotation that he used at the Rose Bowl when they played UCLA. And the numbers on Stewart, Stephenville, he led them to a 4A championship, 16-0 last year in the state of Texas. His numbers on the season, 2 of 5, 37 yards in that first game. Fumble the snap, looking for it, finally gets the handle.
What this comes down to, the last series in this series, is practice time for Tennessee with these quarterbacks in the ballgame. Because you're experimenting here. Bubba Miller, number 71, with his third quarterback in there, Brandon Stewart. Just not a good snap. Ball fumbled. Luckily for Tennessee, Brandon Stewart able to recover.
Bubba, a junior out of Franklin, Tennessee. Very good performer also. Stewart zings it over the middle, and you see why he is highly touted. It's Joey Kemp. Has the reception.
I think when you look at both these freshmen, first of all, for a freshman quarterback to come in the third game against Florida is asking an awful lot. But you look at the presence that both these freshman quarterbacks have. David Cutcliffe, the offensive coordinator, says they're farther along than any freshman quarterback we've ever had. That includes Heath Shuler.
Mike, probably the most fun thing to watch during the week is the competition between these two individually on the practice field. Blitz coming after him. Stewart will be hit, loses the football, and Tennessee has recovered at the 34.
Darren Hambrick, number 42, with a blitz. You just have to learn to read defenses as a freshman coming on the field for the first time. They'll spend a lot of time looking at videotape and progressing as two very skilled freshman quarterbacks.
Well, that's the end of the third quarter with our score, Florida 31 and Tennessee nothing. At the end of three quarters, Florida. Mike, you knew they were good. Did you have any idea they could have this kind of dominance over a good Tennessee team?
I thought with their defensive line, once you can control the line of scrimmage and they're good in the offensive line, so many skilled players, I mean, you're looking at a great football team.
There are the numbers, 10, 14, and 7. It's the breakdown of the scoring by the Gators. Stewart going to run. 5, 10, 15. He's loose. And finally will go out of bounds and got hit out of bounds. Lott finally got to him. That's a gain of 27 yards.
Well, the coaches say that Brandon Stewart, number 6, is a lot like Heath Shuler. He's a lot like the kind of athlete that Heath Shuler is. He can run with the football, and he can throw the football.
Mike, look for Staley. He will take two guys out on this run.
Number 21, Maurice Staley. He's going to get Ben Hanks. He's going to be one of them. You're going to see right there.
Right there, yeah. So the first down chains are moved to the 35. Jay Graham is the only setback. They roll the pocket. The pass is caught by Staley, and he'll take it inside the 25 to the 22-yard line.
The problem when you have three quarterbacks, really they had four with Jerry Colquitt before he got hurt, is who takes the snaps in practice? Brandon Stewart with a good throw on the run. Maurice Staley, number 21. With a good catch, and the chains are moving for Tennessee. An impressive drive by Brandon Stewart.
Tennessee to the line of scrimmage. We'll go to Mike Tirico following the play, get an update from him. A very busy Saturday in college football. Option to the left, in trouble, fumble. Well, he held on to it. Mike, what do you have for us?
Ron, Florida State, Florida, Miami, so dominant. Up to this second, they are winning their games this year by an average score of 52-9. John Stark to Dennis Andrews, his first career touchdown. Seminoles lead Wake by 49. You'll see them against North Carolina next week.
Wow.
Get your tickets for that Florida-Florida State game now.
Now look at tonight's scores as far as the Sunshine State. 31-0, 49-0. In Miami, taking a day off.
They're probably winning right now, too.
They got number 19, Washington, coming up. Backside pressure, and Stewart's going to be sacked. Carter, and that's 5 sacks by this Gator defense.
I keep saying it, but that's the most impressive thing that I've seen in Florida. Watched them practice about 3 weeks ago, before the season actually started. So impressed with Kevin Carter and Ellis Johnson, the other front four. Just
Mike, you know, the two guys though that also have performed that time, it was Campbell who flushed him out of there. Campbell and also Kevin Freeman have been really impressive.
Their whole front seven, and don't forget Dexter Daniels, the middle linebacker. It's an impressive defense. Ben Hanks, the outside linebacker. You know, there was nothing wrong with this defense last year. They're just a year older.
3 of 11 on third down conversion for the ball. Ball has his man open, caught at the 18-yard line, and Sylvan tried to run before he caught it, then had to go back for it, and it caused him a step.
I like the patience of Brandon Stewart. He had good pass protection by the offensive line, but he was able to sit in there long enough for the open receiver, Nilo Sylvan, to come free. See him sit in the pocket. There's no pressure on him. There's no sense for him to start moving with the football. He sat in there. He didn't start to scramble. Found Nilo Sylvan, number 83, an impressive, patient throw by Brandon Stewart.
Henry McMillan senior out of Folkston, Georgia, was applying pressure. Timeout called by Tennessee as they were trying to get a play in, and Stewart came off the bench and called the timeout. 12:01 left in the ball game, and we'll take the timeout with them. So here's the situation. 12:01 left in the ball game. It is fourth down, and the line to make for the Volunteers, the 12 and a half. Stewart deep in the pocket, drills it, and has it complete at the 10-yard line. That will be enough for the Tennessee first down. Billy Williams, the receiver.
That's an impressive throw, Ron, against Larry Kennedy, number three, the defensive back who signed at Ohio State when he came out of high school, but then decided not to go, decided to work. And then Ron Sook, who was an assistant at Ohio State, went to Florida, so he decided to go to Florida. And the Florida fans are happy that he made that decision. Good rifle arm by Brandon Stewart.
Yeah, he really got it in there. Throwback pass, screen to the near sideline at the five, and he tripped over his blocker. Joey Kent was headed for the end zone.
You have to really be impressed with Leslie Ratliff. Again, he's 6'7", 302 pounds, number 75. Brandon Stewart works to the left. Now, see if we pick up number 75 there, Leslie Ratliff, with the block.
You see, and it was Leslie's foot that he tripped over. Otherwise, I think the Volunteers would have had their first touchdown of the night.
You got to remember, he's 6'7". He can't take it all with him.
Brandon Stewart, 4 of 4. You can see his numbers. Kent, 6 catches, by the way, 72 yards. Second down, option. And Stewart is going to be racked up at the line of scrimmage. Daniels, the first man to get there. Also Wright covering up on the play. That's one of those kind of things that maybe in high school that would work, but these guys close a lot quicker.
Not too fast. You have to be impressed tonight with Florida's game plan. Bob Sanders is the defensive tackle coach. Charlie Strong is also in there, works with the defensive ends, defensive tackles. Bob Pruitt, the coordinator, and Ron Sook. Pretty good plan by those four guys.
Gets back to Hayden. Tries to turn the corner, and that is a great job by Ben Hanks. I mean, the lateral pursuit by Florida was relentless.
Ben Hanks, when we talked to him at practice the other day, he said when he went to Florida, a lot of people said, you'll never graduate. And he said, I knew I could make it. I promised my mom, and he's going to graduate in 4 years. He worked so hard, Ron. Steve Spurrier was so impressed with him that he gave his number to him. Brought it out of retirement. Number 11, it was retired jersey. Gave it to Ben Hanks. You're going to see Ben Hanks make the play here.
Fourth down for the Volunteers, and they lost yards. It's going to be a fourth down and 3. Ben Hanks, the junior nickelbacker.
We're not used to playing a full game. They usually have it wrapped up by about 65 to nothing right now, but they're playing into the fourth quarter a little bit gassed. You know, we're talking about the defensive coaches. Carl Franks is an inside linebacker coach. I missed him. I want to give my due to all those defensive coaches for Florida because I thought they had an excellent game plan tonight. Did what they had to do to win, and of course this man on the other side of the ball and his staff.
Well, here's what Steve Spurrier has left.
His toughest game, I think, will be at Mississippi because LSU's an improved team. Auburn is strong, and they won so many games straight. Georgia at home, Southern Miss at home, South Carolina at home, but it's in the swamp, and I think it's tough to beat them down there. At Vanderbilt, when they go into November 26, they take care of business. They're 10-0 when they go into that Florida State ball game.
Mike Philipomer called the entire offensive unit over, including the offensive lineman. It had a talk with him on this fourth down and 3 play. Brandon Stewart. Play action. Looks to throw the ball. No place to go, and he's going to be sacked. Lott gets him behind the line. That will be credited as a sack, and officially the 6th one for the Florida Gators.
When you're the first team defense, you don't want to be scored on, and that was a statement by this Florida defense. Anthon Lott, number 9, makes the play on the naked, but Florida was not going to let them in the end zone, and that's sure what they were talking about on the field. Let's don't give up this shutout. Number 9, Anthon Lott, good coverage again by Florida. They played the play very well.
Mike, they were trying to reverse that out. You could see the influence blocking by the offensive line. He wanted to throw a reverse out pass. They wouldn't let the receiver out.
Anthon Lott, he made the play, knocked the receiver off stride, and then tackled the quarterback.
Fred Taylor, the number 2 tailback for the Florida Gators on the carry. Mike Tirico, what do you have, sir?
Ron, the battle for the bourbon barrel is becoming the Alex Smith Show. This freshman, right now, leads the nation in Division 1A in rushing. He's over 200 yards for the night, 221, 564 thus far in 3 games. Indiana leads by 18.
Ron, you're going to see with the 85 scholarship limit, more and more freshmen popping on the scene and making headlines because they have to play. When you recruit freshmen now, you look for them to play right away.
Taylor on the counterplay. We'll take it to the 12, maybe the 13. Last time that Tennessee was shut out at home was 1980 against Alabama. October the 18th. Right now they're down 31-0. Clock runs about to go under 9 minutes left in this one. Don't forget, immediately following the ball game, we'll be going to Boulder for number 10 against number 7. The Colorado Buffaloes playing host to the Big Ten Badgers of Wisconsin, the defending Rose Bowl champs. Quick pass, and that's caught at the 15. Not enough for the first down. Aubrey Hill made the catch, but with the throw, he had to get out there quickly and went down, lost his footing.
Steve Spurrier trying to answer some critics that say that he hasn't won the big game. Of course, it's 38-5, and I'm sure there's a lot of big games in there, but versus Tennessee and Florida State, 3-5. So this is a nice statement by him also.
Mike, these are all his kids, too. All of these are kids that he recruited.
And they came back from probation, and he has built a solid program. They have great speed on their football team.
Shane Edge, a senior out of Lake City, waiting for the snap back at the 1. Sean Summers has dropped off in a safety for Tennessee. And Florida let it run down to 1 and then called a timeout so they could burn as much time off that clock as they could. Ron Zook, the special teams coach, out on the field.
We talk about people whose motor always runs.
Well, he's played a full game. Look at his shirt. He's soaking wet. And again, I'm going to point out again the fact that he's a nickelbacker coach. Now, nickelbacker, that's a big word there, to be a nickelbacker coach. That means a lot. But he's a special teams coach and coaches one linebacker. Now, last year, he was the defensive coordinator. All he did was win 10 football games and the Sugar Bowl to help his team win. And he unselfishly now coaches the one position and gives pride to the special teams. And there's Ben Hanks, who's the position he coached. That is the nickelbacker.
You've said it 3 times. I think that's enough chances.
The nickelbacker, 4 times.
Don't push your luck.
So Florida burned as much time off that clock as they could, down to 7:55. They let the 25-second clock go down to 1, then call the timeout. 31-0, an edge to kick for the 4th time in this game tonight. And the first one came in the second half, in the third quarter. The line drive kick, Summers from the 50. Gets by tackler, and going to be ridden out of bounds around the 29-yard line. Now here comes the flag again. 36 yards in the kick, 16 on the return, and Xavier McCray is the special teams player who grabbed him.
Doing the run back, blocking the back, receiving team, first down.
So we'll take a break as the penalty will be stepped off. 7:44 left in our ball game. We'll be right back. Gorgeous night in Boulder. 31-0, our score. Florida winning big over Tennessee. And Mike, rushing yardage,
Well, you look at the first two games, 292. Tonight, they could only muster 57 to this point. The difference in the game.
Peyton Manning back in at quarterback. He came in, and followed by Brandon Stewart. They go with a running play. Jay Graham. Graham has had a couple of big bursts tonight. The sophomore out of Kannapolis, North Carolina. 6 feet 206. 16 yards on that run. Points in the first quarter, 14 in the second, and 7 in the third. That's how Florida has arrived at their 31. This time, Jay Graham, not much running room. This is what the Volunteers have left.
Well, you talked about the September 24th game. Now,
I think Mississippi State's a very good football team. They also had this Saturday off, and they're not a pleasure to play in Starkville. In Washington State, Arkansas, Alabama, they get those at home.
Go to South Carolina, get Memphis, Kentucky, who's getting beat tonight, and at Vanderbilt to close out the season. So Mississippi State game really does become a big game for Tennessee now with a 1-2 record.
Injury on the field as you look at Philip Fulmer. This is Dexter Daniels, the inside linebacker who has been such a steady performer for the Gators tonight, is down with what appears to be a left knee or left leg injury.
First and 10. Tennessee.
Mike Adamley, let's check in with you.
Ron and Mike, another impressive thing about this edition of the Gators that speaks volumes about their coaching staff and the integrity of their kids. They are confident, not cocky. They breathe exuberance, but they don't talk trash, and that's refreshing in this day and age.
Well, it does. It does speak well. I said Daniels, as we mentioned, because the Florida kids have been rotated and rested as much as they have. Florida came into this game relatively injury-free, but they're going to have some bumps after this one tonight.
You always do. You're never the same team week to week because of injuries. And, Ron, I'll ask you a question. I like Tommy Frazier for the Heisman Trophy, but Terry Dean has to be making a clear statement that he's getting a little closer for that award also to be considered at least. What do you think?
I don't think there's any question. That's Graham, who was pushed out of bounds at the 6. I just still think there's so much to play in so many situations that, here's a point I'll make to you. As great as Ty Wheatley is, Bianca Batuka up at Michigan has turned a lot of heads as far as the job that he has done up there, as far as being a tough short yardage runner.
Well, you're
not talking necessarily for the Heisman Trophy, but there's
injuries change you every week. J.J. Stokes, for instance, gets knocked out of the ball game.
How about the Martin kid at Pittsburgh? He is a really good running back. As he heads up the middle, it's Graham. James Bates makes the stop. There are the numbers on Dean.
That's pretty good night's work there. 18 and 25, 304. Had the interception, but it was tipped early in the ball game. Ben Talley picked it off with a tipped football.
Don't forget, we'll be selecting the Visa Players of the Game before this one is over tonight. We're about to go under 6 minutes left in the ball game. 3 of 13 on third down conversion. So Peyton Manning with an opportunity to drive his football team into the end zone. Not going to make it here. Eric Lane with the carry. Mike, by the way, the man on the tackle a moment ago, James Bates. His dad, you remember, was the defensive coordinator for the same Florida football team when they came here in 1990. I believe, but he's at Atlanta now.
And he's coaching tomorrow against the Chiefs. And Marty Schottenheimer's boy plays on this Florida team.
Transferred from Kansas.
Mm-hmm. So maybe they'll try to make the game tomorrow. Brian Schottenheimer.
You know, another kid I'd like to bring up. We talk about him every week, but that is McNair, the quarterback. Of course, he has had not only impressive numbers, but everybody you talk to that have seen him play in person say physically, he can run, he can throw, just does the whole thing.
A lot of people feel like he'll be the first draft pick of one of the expansion teams. They feel that highly about him.
First and goal.
Delay a game.
15, 5 yards, the dead ball.
And a lot of folks up at Penn State would say Lieutenant Carter should get a lot of notice as well.
He had 95 yards. They didn't play a long time because they jumped on Iowa right off the bat. He's an impressive running back.
Well, with a 5-yard penalty, 96,656 sitting on the edge of their seats thinking that we need to get in for a touch. We don't want to be blanked. Jay Graham to the left side, hit in the backfield, and it's Mark Campbell.
A soccer player. He's playing some soccer tonight.
I'll tell you, as good as Johnson has been and as good as Carter has been, Mark Campbell, to me, has made some huge plays for Florida.
Well, he's 6'3", 287, and the coaches, when it was down in Florida, talked about his football's ahead of him because he didn't play a lot of football in high school. Just beat the block of Jason Lehman, number 66, made the tackle for a loss.
Tennessee had a first and goal at the 1. Now it's second and goal at the 11. Manning hit. Ball is loose, recovered by Tennessee. Ellis Johnson forced the play.
Well, Warren Sapp is out there for Miami, but I'll tell you one thing. Until I see Warren Sapp play, which will be in a couple weeks, Ellis Johnson has been the most dominating defensive lineman I've watched this year. He just roars up the field, makes the hit on Peyton Manning, causes the fumble. But, Ron, what I like about him is he's always playing hard, 110%, uses his hands well, rushes up the field. He's a pass. He works on the pass, but he's strong on the run. You have to double-team number 61 when you play him in the future.
Manning steps up, looking for the end zone now. Gets it away, got a man open, touchdown Tennessee. 9:07. And now here's a flag at the 15. Did he go beyond the line of scrimmage? Yep, illegal forward pass.
Illegal forward pass. Pass from beyond the line of scrimmage. 5 yards, loss of down.
Well, they should have called it before the fireworks went off.
Could have saved all that money. You know, the thing that Bob Pruitt, the defensive coordinator, will really draw off of on this deal, Mike, Tennessee had a first and goal at the 1-yard line. Now it is fourth and goal, and they're back at the 22. Field goal attempt from Bexford, and the partisan folks are not for this. They'd like to go for a touchdown. Plenty of distance, and he missed it.
It's been the kind of night it's been for Tennessee.
So we'll take a break. 3:24 left in the ball game. Florida 31 and Tennessee nothing. Time. Jason Stanisek today for North Carolina became their career passing leader. He also scored a couple of touchdowns in a shutout win by the Tar Heels. The defense begins to celebrate, and I think they deserve it, Michael. Danny Werfel comes in at quarterback, senior or sophomore, I should say, out of Fort Walton, 6'2", 212. Elijah Williams, 27, now the 28.
I think the difference in this Florida football team, as I try to sum it up, is the two running backs. The threat of the long ball for Steve Spurrier with Elijah Williams and Fred Taylor. Not that they did lose a good player in Eric Rett, but Eric Rett was a pound guy and good pass catcher out of the backfield. But they have so much speed at the wide receivers, good experience line, but now they get the home run threat in the backfield.
Mike, I want to remind people who are wanting to tune in to the Wisconsin and Colorado game. 15 minutes from now, we'll be kicking off up in Boulder, so you're not missing anything. Oh, what a hit on Williams this time.
Williams carries.
Craig Moore comes up and makes the stick out of the secondary, number 17. Very satisfying feeling when you come into a house as tough as this one to play in before almost 97,000 against a football team that is far better than average. And all of a sudden you look at the scoreboard and you are in front 31 to nothing. Feet, you see him dancing and dodging, and he's out to the 41-yard line. Well, tonight's Visa players of the game are, for the University of Florida, Terry Dean, 12 or 18 of 25, just over 300 yards and two touchdown passes. And for Tennessee, our player of the game is Joey Kent, 6 receptions, 71 yards. As a part of their continuing effort to further the development of amateur athletics, Visa proud to donate $1,000 to each of these universities and $1,000 to the U.S. Olympic team on behalf of these athletes.
Well, substitution violation, offense, 5 yard penalty.
And that's twice that would have been called against the Florida Gators. Tyrone Baker, a freshman also from Gainesville, has now committed tailback, the third of the freshman tailbacks that we've seen tonight.
You know, that may be a violation of too many people in the huddle, and they break the huddle, and then a couple people run off the sideline. I think that's what the penalty is, because it's kind of a deception in the defense knowing who's on the field.
Baker will take it close to the 40. About to go under 1 minute left to play. Reminding you, you'll be going to Boulder. You're not going to miss anything. Now probably 12 or 13 minutes before kickoff time up there. The Badgers against the Colorado Buffaloes. Number 10 against number 7. Lawrence Wright, one of the defensive players, and the two freshman quarterback for the Tennessee Volunteers, Peyton Manning and Brandon Stewart, both got an opportunity to show their wares tonight, and both did well until they got inside the 5 yard line.
Both were impressive, and they probably played against one of the top 5 defenses in the country.
I think you're right. That ball is going to be intercepted. Werfel throws it right to Jason Parker, and Parker's off and running. Inside the 20 to the 18. Jason, a junior out of Garland, Texas. That's the first interception thrown by Werfel this year. Only the third by the Gators.
Danny Werfel, backup quarterback, down the middle. Jason Parker, number 7, with the interception. Picks up a couple pretty good blocks. Breaks to the corner and still trying to avoid that shutout, Ron, Tennessee.
Brandon Stewart comes back in at quarterback. Rolls the pocket, looks for the end zone, and now throws it incomplete at the 4. Maurice Staley was the intended receiver.
There's going to come a time when they have to end the shuttling in of the two freshman quarterbacks, and somebody has to establish himself because of practice time. Be interesting what happens at Tennessee in this week of practice. Who starts against Mississippi State?
Well, the coaches actually say, you know, they're just waiting for somebody to separate, for somebody to separate themselves. Tipped and caught by Tennessee at the 6 yard line. Andy McCullough got the carry.
Take a look at Florida's scoring by quarters. It's total domination. The fourth quarter, 35-0 to the 3 opponents. And, of course, everybody questioned the first 2 games because they said it was New Mexico State and Kentucky. But tonight, against a pretty good Tennessee football team, they've dominated them also.
Seconds left as Phil Fulmer talks with his quarterback, Steve Spurrier, about to win his first game here in Knoxville as the head coach at the University of Florida. I would remind you, it's the second time that he has won here. He did it as the head coach at Duke.
Said he was at Duke in 1982 as an assistant. He came up here and played Tennessee. They had Reggie White and Bill Bates. And he said they played so well on offense at Duke that Tennessee only had one possession in the fourth quarter. And Duke had a one-point lead with 9:52 on the clock and took the ball over at their own one. And when the game ended, it was on the Tennessee one. They had that drive. And he said that's one of the games I remember the most of when I coached.
Stewart from a shotgun with 17 ticks left on the clock. Pass for the end zone, almost intercepted. Darren Hambrick cut in front. And Darren knows that he was about 100 yards away. And let's go to Mike Tirico. And we will visit with Michael in just a moment. In about Mike's, 12 more seconds.
Mike's following all those scores, and I bet he's following that Syracuse-Rutgers game tonight, which is probably a close football game. That's going to decide who's going to be the second and third team in the Big East.
No penalty. No penalty.
Ron, as I look out in the field, still number 61. You're at 31-0, and the shutout means a lot to this defense. Number 61, Ellis Johnson, is still in on defense. Campbell, Mark Campbell, they want to preserve the shutout with 12 seconds to go.
Brandon Stewart is going to be sacked. That is 7 sacks by this Florida defense. Ben Hanks is the man that got him. The Florida Gators win it 31-0. For Mike Gottfried and Mike Adamley, Ron Franklin saying so long from Knoxville, Tennessee. Mike Tirico, let's throw it to you.